Because if I don't record it, we won't have any recording. Right. And here we go. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 403. Ria for Hudson Division. I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG. And this will actually be my second episode of the day. I haven't posted the first one, but it will go up soon. But I have a special guest today to bring you. And just keeping in following all the stuff that's going on at headquarters at the ARRL, I've brought Ria back. I'm really excited to support her and to continue to follow the elections for division directors as we go forward. So I'm going to bring you Ria. Hi, Ria.
Hey, hello there. How are you doing, David?
I'm good today. I'm good, minus my broken finger. but I am good. I'm awesome. I'm so happy to be able to do two episodes today and, that you're able to join me.
Right.
And, I want to talk a little bit about what's going on in your campaign.
Well, quite a lot, actually. You know, September is going to be the big push, as they say, because the ballots go out October 1st, no later than. The biggest news of all, of course, is that I'm now officially certified as a candidate. Rather quickly, and I was quite surprised.
That's awesome.
All five have been certified, which is good. Although they're independent, you know, it's nice to see other people step up a change, and I'm really happy to see that. It really warms my heart. Other news would be we have three YLs in this election, myself, Valerie Hotzfeld, and one in the Northwestern Division. I support two out of three. Because two out of three are on the transparency side. And in the Northwestern Division, I support Mike Ritz because he is on the transparency side. I'll tell you, YLRL is thrilled about this election. It's historic, but, you know, of course, we're keeping the issues in mind. And this is not about only electing somebody because they're whatever. It's about transparency. It's about bringing ARL back. It's about forward thinking. And it's a word I've been using a lot. Forward thinking.
Yeah, and I think I've been thinking the word is change, but I like forward thinking.
Yeah.
That definitely covers a lot of it.
Right. Because, you know, I think for the most part, a lot of people think ARL is operating behind, like two decades behind is a common theme I hear. And I think it's pretty sad that for a technology hobby, we're not on the cutting edge, or at least not close to it, or at least not current. I think that in terms of a lot of the web technology and all of the other stuff, that they're just not keeping up, you know, and the membership too is another big push of mine. Mm-hmm. Why did we lose 5,000 last year when we are at the highest number of amateur radio licensees ever?
Yeah, that definitely came up in the Yuma Ham Fest that I covered. Dick Norton spoke a little bit about that and was looking for ideas on how to grow membership while we're all growing as a amateur radio community.
Yeah, and I'll tell you this, maybe it's funny, hold a competitive election and people say they're joining ARL to vote, you know, and maybe people just don't feel involved. They don't feel that they have a voice anymore. So I've had people literally tell me, Ria, I'm rejoining to vote for you. I'm like, wow.
That's amazing. Well, I think that was a lot of the concern, you know, as we started to cover the My ARL Voice early in the year, was the whole transparency movement. I think that's really critical. I think for me to want to continue to support the ARL, and I'm a member, and I will be a member, that I need to feel like somebody, you know, cares about what we're doing, and that I have the ability to hear about what's going on. Oh, there you go.
You're I'm a life member. I'm a lifer.
Yeah.
So, you know.
That's a big thing.
I'm in this for life, you know, for good or for bad, for better or for worse, yeah. Till death do us part, right? So, it is what it is. I have to find space for it among my other plaques, but.
Hanging up on the wall there somewhere.
Yeah. It is interesting that there is so much being made of life members. I think there is some kind of grumbling that life members, you know, they joined for X amount of dollars way back, and then now they're not really, you know, paying dues anymore. Yet they're kind of keeping the numbers up in some respects. And a lot of them are big donors too, mm-hmm. You know? And I think it's really, you know, we should appreciate those folks rather than just throw them under the bus, you know?
I absolutely agree. I wish I had the funds to be able to do that someday. Maybe as we get additional support for the show here, I'll make that investment. And I think it is important. I think it definitely says something that there are so many life members, people out there that really, you know, care about the division, about the organization, to be able to do that.
Yeah, and you know, and care about the mission. And the mission for me really is the promotion and future survival of amateur radio.
Yeah.
Because with the membership numbers especially, you'll find that right now we're at what, 25%, and they're projecting 2-3% per year. What happens when we drop below 1 in 5? Is the FCC going to take us seriously? What about Congress?
Mm-hmm.
You know, Bill Nelson, is he going to be scared of us, or he's just going to laugh us off?
Well, and I think it's pretty clear that Bill, he's just kind of holding us at bay at this point, and just kind of holding us up. Although I know that there are some out there that wonder if maybe he's not doing us a favor based on the changes in the wording of the new bill that's in Congress right now. You know, it used to be a must, and now it's a may. I wonder about that. I'm hoping that there's a better introduction as we go forward.
Yeah, and you know, I think that the whole Parity Act thing, I think we definitely need to look at better solutions for that than the current one we have now. For one, Fred Hoppengarten's running in New England, and I'm thrilled to have him because he is definitely going to be a good legal eagle on the board. Mm-hmm. Provided he wins, which I'm pretty sure he has the chops and he has the momentum to win. And we just need to have that sort of expert voice in the league. You know, the Jim Talens, N3JT, wrote a lot of stuff about the Parity Act and why that we should, you know, restructure it. Now back to Fred. People are saying, well, what does, I remember Lysenko, you might have listened to the recording where my opponent was at a club meeting, and then somebody asked him, well, what does she propose? And then he says, well, I'll let her describe that. I propose exactly what Fred Hoppengarten proposed. He had a long, a concise yet detailed account of what would be a good version of the Parity Act, where you'd have like safe harbors and default, you know, stepladder approach where you can have for certain types of properties. You have, this is the minimum that would be allowed, and then you work your way up from there. Like, you don't expect 100-foot towers in a condo, right?
Right.
You probably have that kind of thing in a 10-acre property, for example. And all of that's there. I don't know why it's just being ignored. And, you know, you see all the rhetoric at the meetings saying, well, you know, they have no, they're saying it's bad and they have no plan, and that's nonsense, I think.
Yeah, we did a really good episode with Fred when this all started up, when there were changes going on and some of the stuff around the Parity Act. And so if you go back, I'm trying to find the episode number. It's in the 350s somewhere. And we did a kind of a good breakdown of what was in the bill, what the changes were made, and why there were concerns about it. And I know Fred wasn't in support of the bill as it stands today, because of some of those changes in the wording. And you know, that's the thing about legalese. It's just, you know, changing the word from shall to may changes the whole power structure of it all.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I know exactly what you're talking about, but, it definitely does have that kind of effect, and one word could basically change it all.
Yep. Yep. So let's get back to your drive here towards Hudson Division. Have you been making the rounds and going to visit clubs, and how is that going for you?
Absolutely. I'll tell you what, there are a lot of clubs, and I'm kind of disappointed, but I also view it as an opportunity. There are a lot of people who are basically starting from scratch with this. They don't know any of the issues because maybe they've not really been urged to pay attention, or maybe they've just not really, you know, had any awareness of the issues. But I've gone to several clubs, and September is going to be an absolutely loaded month with club meetings. I've been actually campaigning since before field day. I went to several clubs on field day. I visited WECA. I visited several clubs in each section. And I've been going to club meetings. I've been to club meetings in Eastern New York, in Northern New Jersey, and New York City, Long Island. Just this week, I was actually at the Great South Bay Amateur Radio Club, and they are a fantastic club. They gave me a really good reception, and I made a lot of people think, and I gathered a lot of support from people, and I think they are really enthusiastic about this too. So, you know, it's surprising because Great South Bay is actually a club in Mike's backyard, you know, so he's, you know, to get that kind of support there is amazing.
So how are you doing this? Are you just going, you're calling up the clubs and going to visit and seeing if they'll give you time to speak about, you know, your platform and what you want to do with the league?
Well, one thing I noticed early on is that some clubs are really active with speaking engagements, so you have to book them early. I started this process all the way in May, and I've been booking up speaking engagements to mid-October. And I've had some clubs on the calendar for a long time, and I've had clubs reaching out to me, either because, one, my opponent has reached out to them, or two, they are interested in a message. So I've basically had that thing. But what I've done too is I've gone through the affiliated clubs list and I've just cold called them. I've been basically just emailing them. Then I have other contacts, other people working for me, like Frank Fallon, N2FF, the former retired director. He went and talked to the clubs in Long Island, and several of them are coming up. I'm actually going all the way out to Peconic end of next week. Peconic is up by the Forks in Long Island, if you know where that is.
I don't.
Yeah, it's like it's on the easternmost part of Long Island.
Okay, got it. So you're going north, or
no? I'm going east.
East, okay.
Yeah.
So you're doing a lot of travel. How many visits do you think you have planned between now and when we get to voting?
I have close to 40.
Wow.
I would say. I'm at a club meeting almost every night.
Wow, that's amazing. You're really dedicated to this.
Yeah, I'm telling you. I'm working to get every single vote. I've even gone to Mike's home club in Brooklyn, where his webmaster is a president, and they let me speak, and I got support there.
Uh-huh. What are you hearing? So are there questions for you? Are they asking you about what your platform is, or what you're looking to do? How does it go?
Well, so first of all, the issues, the political issues in ARL, people tend to ask. Some people didn't know that there are these proposals put forward. Mm-hmm. And that's understandable because they were done basically kind of under the radar. And they would get a notification after the fact. So people, when I mentioned that to them, they asked me about those things. That's one. The other thing I get asked about is technology and future plans. And one guy asked me about fiber connections at headquarters and all that kind of stuff. He's an old telco guy, so I guess that's his his thing. I get other people asking me about, no, one pointed question I get, which is probably, I would say, a planted question. How do you deal with the quote-unquote old guard in the league? I said, first of all, we're hoping to get a good majority of reformers, right? Although that's not what I'm hinging on. The other thing is, basically, I am very passionate about amateur radio, and I've been known in the corporate world to push my projects and get my point across and basically win approval, not by force, but through persuasion. And I basically have persuaded people to spend tens of millions of dollars on projects and take gambles, and that's how it works with me.
Excellent, excellent. And are you going to these meetings? Is your competitors there? Is there one other person running, the incumbent, or is there another one as well?
It's a two-way race.
Just
which is great.
Just you and just you and Mr. Lyshenko.
Yeah, me and the incumbent.
The current incumbent. Uh huh.
Yeah, so Dusty and Cummins and me, and we're going to some of the same clubs.
Mm-hmm.
He tends to, I notice he is present in Northern New Jersey. He goes to Northern New Jersey clubs because Northern New Jersey, for one, has more members than any other section, which is good for me, but he has to work here. And the other thing is that sometimes he goes to clubs that I go to later, And like you heard, he would say things, and I would go later and explain, well, you know, he's not being candid with you. I even wrote a blog post about the Parity Act where he said that Fred Toppengren's on board with the Parity Act now, and that they've kissed and made up. And I'm like, no. And then Fred is like, I absolutely still oppose. Mm-hmm. So, you know, sort of like these sort of non-candid statements and kind of just veering on half-truth and stuff like that has just been going around club meetings. And I've had to go and basically not really play defense, but set the record straight. And when people learn about it, they're like, okay. And they don't really appreciate when people are not candid with them.
Right.
So it tends to turn people off when they hear things like that.
Yeah, I bet. So you shared a recording with me. Before we get to it, give me a little... Fill us all in on what this is all about before we play it out there. I want everybody to understand you know, where it came from and what the setting was. And then
right.
We'll get into that a little bit.
This was a club meeting sent to me unsolicited in northern New Jersey at a club meeting. And this was the incumbent campaigning at a club meeting and basically just laying into me and saying all sorts of things. You'll hear some of the ridiculous things, but the most ridiculous one I've heard is that she has a 75-foot tower and she doesn't support the Parity Act because of that, which is nonsense. You know, that's like saying you're sighted and you don't support blind people, which is nonsense, you know. It's just, you know, it's angry, political, divisive rhetoric aimed to get one set of people against the other.
Mm-hmm.
And he misused my letter where I told him, I said that my ARL voice, because, you know, Rick Roderick, actually, the president of ARL, described the My ARL Voice as a misinformation campaign.
Yep.
And I wrote in the letter, I said, this is not a misinformation campaign. These are some of the brightest and the best, the cream of the crop in amateur radio, who are involved in contesting, DXing, and radio support, and also emergency communications leaders. I made sure I mentioned that because there are several of them who are emergency communications leaders, and I've been involved in MCOM and public service for a long time too. So it's a big tent, and he just left out that part. And he said, well, you know, I refer to these people as the 10%, and he basically implied that they're a bunch of elitists trying to run the league, which I didn't really appreciate because I view this as a big tent. If we have an emergency or disaster, I'm going to volunteer my station, my time.
Mm-hmm.
And I've done emergency activations. I've operated post 9/11, which was the biggest one. I've done New York City Marathon so many years with Steve Mendelson. I think I've raised money for like maybe 15 different diseases, cures for them in New York City alone. So I don't know what he's talking about. I even worked with him on the MCOM courses. I was actually an examiner when he was doing the MCOM courses for ARES. So
yeah, I know a number of the folks that are supporting them, my ARL voice, and I didn't have the take when that letter came out. I didn't have the feeling that he got it. It just seemed to me like political spin. You know, you're in this camp or you're in that camp, and no matter what camp you're in, you know, it's got to be my way or the highway. And that was very frustrating for me because I talked to a number of the guys as well, and I have some follow up to do with a couple of them, and there'll be some shows coming up with them and with some of the other candidates that are running against incumbents, because I think we need change. Or what was your term for it?
We need forward thinking.
Forward thinking. Absolutely.
Yeah. Now, with the forward thinking basically means we need to break away from some of the old ways that, you know, one of the biggest things I've heard is that we've always done it this way, but that's a sure recipe for failure. So I think we need to break away from that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, do you want to get in this recording a little bit?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Okay. I'm going to play it for you. So I understand that this was recorded at a ham club meeting in New Jersey.
Right.
And I will start the recording now, and go ahead and feel free to talk over it.
Okay.
As we go.
So this is where he's talking about the new CEO.
I can't discuss anything about him or our
You can hear it all right, yeah?
Yeah, I'm hearing it.
Okay. Good deal.
And this individual, of course, has to tie up loose ends in the...
We all know who the CEO is, by the way.
But it's somebody who I think is very... very good in that position. I'm not on the search committee. And in fact, the search committee is very tight political also. I don't know. We had close to 40 people actually apply.
No, I've said this on my aerial voice that there have been 40 people applying for a job, and this is where I got it from.
Okay.
All right, now this is where basically that part was cut out and it goes into a new one. You could listen for a bit.
Okay.
The experience that's needed to be effective in the position of director, my opponent sadly is not. And you all know me. You know the work that I've done on behalf of the Hudson Division. There's much work still to be done, and I'd like to continue providing support and advocacy for the Hudson Division, the URL, in our division, in Newington, and in Washington. Now, my opponent would have you believe that this job requires no experience, and that I'm a good old boy who's complacent, not in tune with the necessities of the position. Well, frankly, that's political rhetoric designed to sound like a reformer, but it's just that, folks, it's rhetoric. She claims to have experience working in...
Somebody said, can I leave now?
I heard that. That is not ARRL, where she has little or no experience in management. She's had no experience as an individual who has a fiduciary responsibility to a corporation, its well-being, its employees, and in the case of the league, its members. And experience really is the key. It really is. Now, if you have to believe that the sky is falling and that the board is destroying the league.
Can we just pause here for a second?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, the sky is falling and that he's a good old boy. Well, you know, sometimes some of these things might actually ring true, but he uses those words. And it's the irony is he talks about rhetoric, and the words he's using actually are rhetoric. So he is part of this whole group in the league that is in favor of a more closed and, you know, quote unquote, we know better board, which really is not going to function very well as a membership advocacy organization. And then he talks about experience. The funny thing is that my experience outside of you know, amateur radio dwarfs anything he has in ARL. He's been a director for... since 2012, I think. And I helped him, by the way, I helped him win in Northern New Jersey. He wouldn't tell you that. He came to me and asked me for help in Northern New Jersey, and I pointed him to some key clubs, including my club, which is the North Jersey DX Association. And he had no experience outside, no corporate experience outside of ARL, and now he's lecturing people on fiduciary duty. Fiduciary duty simply means loyalty. And, you know, it's a little more complex than that, but I'm aware of fiduciary duty. I work in the financial industry right now, and I've been working in the financial industry before the crash. And, you know, I've worked for major corporations. I didn't just work for one Fortune 500 company. I have over 20 years experience. So, you know, I think he's misrepresenting that a little bit. And, you know, the whole sky is falling thing is there are people who are seriously concerned. But you'll hear him talk about that a little more. So if you want to continue, or if you want to...
No, that's, you know, that's fine. I think we can continue on. I get the feeling. I could go on and on about the whole sky is falling thing, but I don't want to take it too far down that road.
No problem.
During my tenure as Hudson Division Director, I held cabinet meetings consisting of club presidents and officials, section managers, field organization, and assistant directors in each section. These meetings held twice yearly in each section involved more participants than ever before from my predecessors. I've also held the first town hall webinar for the rank and file membership of the division, which had over 200 participants sign up for it. And let's not forget the thousands of miles traveled to attend club meetings, speaking engagements, and handfests over the year, all of which has served as an outreach to the membership in an effort to find out firsthand of what...
Let's pause for a little bit here. Yeah. Now, first of all, the cabinet meetings are a good thing, but he is implying that basically that you know, he's running against his predecessors. I am not his predecessors. And I tell people that, that, for example, one of the predecessors didn't like to go to further than basically spend all their time in northern New Jersey. And I have none of those issues. I go all over the division. It's easier for me, actually, to drive to upstate New York, Orange County, or even as far as Saratoga than it is for him to navigate Brooklyn traffic to that. But that aside, the fact that he's talking about, what was the last point he made? I just lost it in my mind there. He was talking about the webinar, the town hall.
Yep.
What was your impression of that webinar? Was it proactive or reactive?
First of all, it was really hard to hear. That was for doing an online thing, it was really low quality, especially if we're communicators, you know.
Right.
It was very inflammatory. It was very dismissive. Mm-hmm. It was frustrating. I felt a little lectured to.
Right.
That was it's been a little while since I've listened to it, but that was my recollection. The takeaway was it was very preachy. And
And you know what it was? It was also reactive. It was reactive to the uproar caused by all of these issues that they've been having. He wouldn't have had this had people not stepped up and complained and had the outpouring of angry letters into the league. You know, I have a picture of the letters that he threw up and put on the boardroom floor, as somebody told me. I'm taking their word for it, but, you know, I wouldn't doubt it. You know, so there's a tone problem, and I tell people there's a definite tone problem. And I hate to first focus on personalities, but if you're a communicator, what do people do in amateur radio before they go and talk on a frequency? They stop and they listen.
Yeah.
So if you're listening to your, if you want to get the best communication with your membership, you got to listen to them. And I've heard many opposing points of view to my stuff, and I just listen and I tell them, okay, you know what? That's a different viewpoint. I disagree with you, but it's your right to have it. And I might try to convince them, but, you know, I don't dismiss them outright. So, you know, that was basically the whole thing about the town hall. He's preaching this as transparency, but it was purely reactive. I mean, it's not really what I would consider. I think if he really wants to garner support, he shouldn't go around telling people, well, I held the first town hall. Yeah, you held it because people were angry and upset of what you did. Well, so,
and what we felt all along when we talked about this earlier, in terms of, you know, what's going on, all this stuff happened, the censure of N6AA and all of this code of conduct thing, and then to have them come back and say, you know, that, you know, we'd understand as our constituents, you know, we put them there and they have to make the big decisions. It was very talk down to me like I'm a child. I don't understand. You don't understand. And we're very open and we're not an old boys club. Well, you have to decide. It's one thing or the other. We're included in it and we know what's going on, or we're not. And that seems to be my frustration there. And there's part of me that wondered from the West Coast if this isn't a New York thing, right? And I don't have anything, nothing wrong with New Yorkers. New York is a great place. But there is that stereotypical way New Yorkers may come off. And I think in the beginning when I started listening to this before I knew or had a lot of experience with it, I had kind of brushed it aside to say, okay, that's just one of those cultural things, right? And, you know, it's a cultural thing. But as I listen more, I get that it's not so much.
No, it isn't, because I have gotten some of the best from New York City, Long Island section in particular. Like when I went out to Great South Bay, they absolutely rolled out the red carpet for me, because I actually went on one of their lighthouse activations on Fire Island, and they were the sweetest, most welcoming group of amateurs that I have seen in a long time. That's not to say, you know, hams are not like that, right? But they absolutely went out of their way to make sure that I was comfortable and that I was there, able to operate, and that I was also well fed, and also that I got a tour of the lighthouse, you know. So yeah, it's I'm telling you, it's not a New York thing. It's him. It's just, you know, he has this attitude. If you,
yeah, I have a sense of that.
Yeah, if you look at the picture of him in front of the league, you know, it basically, and you've seen that famous picture of him in front of the league, right? By the sign, you know?
Maybe not.
Yeah, if you look on his QRZ or on his webpage, you'll see him standing with one leg crossed in front of the league. To me, that implies to me that he's saying, well, I own this. And I'm like, okay.
Got it.
And he says, you know, he refers to it as my seat. I'm like, well, you know, I refer to it as your seat, as my division's seat. And I'm just a humble servant. I'm just the person who is going to represent you. You know, this is not my anything.
Right. You know? He's our person. Well, he's your person. Right. I always wonder that with elected officials, when you hear the my or the, you know, or the your, that's kind of a tell to me, right? You know, you're my people versus I am your representative.
Right.
I want the person that's my representative. I don't want, you know, I don't belong to them. They're there to help speak my voice.
Exactly.
All right. Shall we go on? Okay.
Yeah, let's go on.
You. Now, she implies that the board operates in secret. That's such a problem. There really is. There's no secrecy, especially in this division, where I have a reputation for always being a straight talker. I have always been open and honest with the membership. My votes are on the record and recorded in the minutes. All the board votes are listed in the minutes of all board committee meetings. That is transparency. Now, she complains that the amateur radio parody act is bad, that the league should have consulted others, and that
we should
continue to support the legislation. Well, quite frankly, that's easy for her. I want to say because she has a 75 with power outside the
board. What's the alternative that she offers?
Huh?
What alternative does she offer? If the Parity Act is no good.
Next month.
All right, so let's just touch on this a little bit.
So you're gonna go talk to them?
I already did.
Okay.
And they're very much, if you look at my Facebook page, I had a very good reception. Every club I go to, I get with few exceptions, I get thunderous applause, and I get people that are interested. And I hate to say it, but as much as it's not a begging for money thing, people donate, and I appreciate their generosity too. And those donations will be used to further the message. I mean, there are several outreach efforts which I'm keeping under my hat right now because I don't want him to get ideas. But
there was the question of the Parity Act and what the right. What the participant there asked you was asked Mike was, well, what's your platform? So let's talk about what do you think? Where do you fall on it?
Well, I have several different opinions of the Parity Act that all align into one thing. The one thing I will tell you right off the bat is that the current act is not going to be beneficial, and it's going to be harmful for radio amateurs. And this is something that is shared by nearly every prominent antenna law attorney, right? That I've spoken to. There's been, Fred Hoppengarten, Jim Talens, and there are a few others, like Bob Familio. You'll probably be end up talking to him.
Yep.
He is one, and there are other people who he's a former member of the board too, who was disqualified. But there is absolutely no support for this, and the platform that I agree with was the one that Fred put in his paper, which was you have the stepladder approach. You have for condos and small properties like that, you have, you know, verticals, flagpoles. You have minimally visible antennas for small lots, right? And then you have for larger lots, you can talk about larger antennas, right? And then you have these minimum safe harbors, right? Safe harbor is a legal term. He's never talked about that, but, you know, Fred's paper mentions safe harbors that will provide a minimum for people, just like the OTARD regulation, O-T-A-R-D.
So it's about right sizing, right?
Yeah, and the thing is, realistically, even under municipal regulations, in a lot of places, you're not going to get a 100-foot tower in a postage stamp size lot. It's just not going to happen.
Right.
But if you have 10 acres, yeah, that might happen.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are 10-acre properties that are HOA controlled. Right. I'm sure N3HBX had a problem with his neighbors. I don't think it was HOA related, though, but he had acres and acres of property in Superstation in Maryland. And his neighbors didn't want it. So I had problems here, and I talked to my building department with Fred's advice. So I bought Fred's book, and I emailed Fred, and he told me exactly what to do, and I won. And not only did I win, but now there is a written procedure in town hall to deal with amateur antennas. So, you know, that's a big win for me. Mm-hmm. I don't think Mike has really had that.
And I think the concern when we talk about the current bill is, you know, when it was first proposed, the bill was written shall allow, and then at some point it got softened down to may allow based on the HOA. And you know, again, my biggest concern is that the HOAs are going to start to realize what they have in front of them, and they're going to start pushing for this bill because they benefit the most based on the conversation we had with Fred and Jim on the show late last year. They have the most to gain from this. It actually strikes me that they're not rallying around this because it does give them more ability to limit what can be done in an HOA setting.
Well, I mean, yeah, right now the status quo benefits them, right? That the contract is a contract and you cannot put up any antennas, period.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the actual ARPA right now would change very little for them.
Right.
What it would do is people in other associations, like lake associations, like my friend Andrea at K2 Echo Zoo lives in a lake association, Lake Mohawk in Sparta, and she has antennas. And if this act is passed, if she wants to change those antennas, she's going to have to talk to the lake association. And the Lake Association is probably going to throw their hands up in the air and said, well, we don't know. We don't know if that's going to give us cancer,
mm-hmm.
you know, because that's what they say now, right?
Mm-hmm.
We don't know, you know, so it's going to be tough, and they're going to be required by federal law now.
Right, to get that approval, or you're breaking the law.
Right. Yeah,
and I think that's the big challenge. All right, let's go back and play some more.
Onward.
Let's go back. She still has a 75-foot tower outside her door.
He loves
me. I'm always amazed that the loudest opponents of this bill have better than average antenna farms on their property. It's just mind-boggling. It's the height of selfishness. It's okay for them to have a 75-foot tower, but the folks in Florida or California or Texas who live in a deed-restricted community, and they don't necessarily choose to live in a deed-restricted community. They sometimes have to, right? Are crying to me that they can't get on the air, and what are they going to do without this legislation? And I don't have an answer other than to try to get the goddamn thing passed. I don't understand the arrogance of that. I just don't. And I can't tell you how many times people have called me or written to me from all over the country, almost crying, you know, and it's just not right. Now, understand that the bill was negotiated at the insistence of the House Subcommittee Chairman and a ranking member. When we first brought the initial bill to the Telecommunications Subcommittee of the United States House of Representatives Commerce Committee, we were told flat out the bill will never leave this committee if you guys can't sit down and hammer out some sort of agreement, you know, that builds a consensus between the two associations.
That's like a wolf and two lambs agreeing on what's for dinner, okay?
Yeah.
The bill would have died in committee if we had. Now, I'm proud to say that I was part of that process, and that the bill has now passed the House of Representatives four times. and we still keep on working to get this thing done. It is arguably the most important piece of legislation that faces amateur radio today. No one has had the success I've had in obtaining congressional support for any legislation ever, ever. Now, I recognize that no legislation is perfect. In an effort to be as inclusive as possible and try to bring the amateur community together, because quite frankly, if we don't hang together, we will hang separately.
Wow, he's voting Ben Franklin now.
Our most harsh critic on the Parity Act. We've started with consultations with him about the implementation petition at OCC that we plan to file when the bill passes. Fred has but still does not like the Parity Act as a bill, but he's pledged his support, his full support, and help to get our implementation effort. So we are working together.
And has Fred backed it?
Well,
I'm going to reach out. I'm going to reach out to Fred about that.
First of all, in his town hall, he told me, we didn't see the need to reach out to Fred. Okay. And now he's reaching out to Fred. Well, I reached out to Fred. You can reach out to Fred too. And Fred told me specifically that not only am I not okay with it, I strongly oppose it.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, that was what was in our earlier show. Fred was not in support of this.
Yeah, I mean, I wrote a whole blog post on this, and you can see it. It's called New Endorsements and a Note About the Truth. And then you can see where it says, my opponent has not been candid with you. I'm told at the club meeting, he said something like, Attorney Fred Hoopengarten, K1VR, does not like the Parity Act, but he has pledged full support in its implementation. I reached out to Fred to see what he said about that. He replied, this implies that I don't like it, but I could live with it. Wrong. My position is much stronger than does not like. I actively oppose it. Only if it passes have I expressed a willingness to seek the best possible implementation, because my interest is always in the best interest of amateur radio. So, you know.
So if Fred gets stuck with it, Fred will work with it.
Yeah, but it's not like Fred
doesn't support it.
Right. He said no such thing. And this is a common theme that you hear at club meetings, that he will take part of somebody's words, twist it, and then make it into something else.
How many people were at this meeting? Do you have any idea? You weren't there.
No, I wasn't. What somebody told me, I think it was like 20 or 25. I mean, generally it's like a small room. I think it might be like a senior center or something. So.
Okay. All right, let's continue on here.
Yeah.
Now, let's talk a little about governance. My opponent believes that the ARRL Board of Directors' code of conduct is too severe and stringent, and in some ways she's right. However, today's litigious society is necessary to have a set of rules to be followed by those entrusted with the health and well-being of the league. Now, I don't know that to be true, because the league's corporate attorneys tell us so. My position is this. I support a code of conduct that is flexible so that it can adapt to the needs of the board and the league. A code that establishes ground rules that deal with the way the board members coexist with staff. And let me tell you something, folks, we're no different than any other place of business where you have people working together, all right, and you have all sorts of situations arise, be they harassment, be they misunderstandings, be they social issues. People work in an environment. They need some sort of set of protocols and rules in order to get us paid. So I need to see a code that establishes those ground rules that deal with the way the board members coexist with the staff. And let me tell you something. Sometimes I've seen some staff react to board members, not a pleasant situation. Right? So a code that provides the tools that allows for the accomplishment of these required tasks, and a code that satisfies our legal requirements and therefore allows the board to fulfill our responsibilities to the membership and to the league, and yes, the league. What my opponent doesn't seem to understand is that the 15 directors have a fiduciary responsibility to the league as well as the members, and that sometimes the needs of the corporations outweigh the desires of the membership.
Yeah, and this is what I take issue with, where... Yeah. He says, okay.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Sorry. Where he says that the needs of the members The needs of the league outweigh the league need of the membership. So what is the league? Who is the league?
Yeah, the corporate entity outweighs the needs of the members.
That does not compute, first of all.
Right.
I mean, you know, if you want to start a corporation, start a corporation. But yeah. this is our national association for amateur radio. Without us, it would not exist. When Hiram Percy Maxim started up, he said everything. He wrote an editorial in 1927 QST that I feature prominently on my webpage on Hudson.N2RJ.com, where it says, everything that ARL undertakes must be 100% for the general good. That policy bred loyalty and confidence. With those two things, an organization can prosper forever. It did not say that everything ARL undertakes must be for the league first. It must be for everybody. And if the league is not serving its members, why is the league existing? I want the league to exist, but if it's not, its priority is not member service and service to amateur radio, why is it there? You know? So, you know, if they want to take this, you know, I've heard some things where people have said, you know, they're unfounded, but I could believe it, where people are saying, well, you know, there are cases where the league's, you know, benefit will take priority over membership. And he just came out and confirmed that. So,
yeah, there is definitely a belief. Yeah. And I've heard that before, that there are times, and a similar quote to that, right, where that the league, the corporation, it takes priority. And, you know, I think the corporation is mostly us and the book publishing, right? I mean, that's the main source of income is the book publishing and our membership magazine. And the magazine. I'm not even sure the magazine makes a lot of revenue. Because it comes out of our, you know, out of our membership dollars. But I think of the league as a representation of my membership, not as a corporate entity that I've bought into as a, you know, as a member.
As a shareholder.
Right. Right.
Yeah. And you know, he's playing with fire here because he's talking about my inexperience and stuff like that, quote unquote. Well, I mean, you know, I have arguably more experience than him in terms of corporate matters, because I've basically been on the inner workings of large corporations. And, you know, I've had to sit in front of CEOs, and my boss was the chief digital officer of the corporation. He had a C title. So, you know, and I worked directly with him, and he explained to me a lot of issues that he talked about in the boardroom with powerful people. And, you know, so I know these issues probably a lot better than him. I can tell you that in a nonprofit that deals with member service, you do not have the same issues that you have in a public company that right. deals with shareholders
right.
and customers, because, right. you know, the reason for league existing is not to make money. It is to service membership. And if the membership service goes away, and this goes back to the issue about membership numbers, and I tell people that if you notice that I talk about the membership numbers, well, if you read in the AARL annual report, the most damning thing I see is that, well, the decline is fine because we're still balancing the books. That to me is absolutely unacceptable, because it shows a lack of priority. It shows where the actual priorities are, and the priority is for the corporation and not for the members, which is wrong.
The revenue stream, not growing the membership.
Yeah. And I mean, if the revenue, you know, they're saying, well, you know, we raise dues and people are going to drop their membership. Sure. But what happens when we drop below 20%, I always say, you know, we it all falls apart.
We start losing credibility when we go to the FCC and others, if we're not really representative of the amateur radio operator out in, you know, at large.
Right. And, you know, like you said, you're not a life member. You have the choice to drop your membership, right? Mm-hmm. I don't, you know?
Well, I won't, but,
Yeah. But I'm saying there are many people who make that decision. They Absolutely. Figure, well, you know, it's not financially viable for them, or they don't. And, you know, it's not so much raw money. It's that people said, well, I'm paying this $49 a year. I don't know what I'm getting for it, you know? Well, you get somebody who goes to Washington. Who goes to Washington to do what? Pass a piece of legislation that's going to turn an HOA Dollingham into a criminal? Mm-hmm. Or something else.
And I think a lot of the people here that I talk to think that the membership is just a magazine subscription. And we try to educate them to let them know that it's way more than that. The magazine is a benefit of it. But, you know, you compare it to something like and it's not a good comparison, but like AAA, you know, the Automobile Association of America, right? You get a magazine with that, but you get a lot of more service and you get representation. Nobody's going to come tow my tower away when it breaks down. But it's more aligned to that than the corporate entity of, you know, whatever, you know, Ralston right. Purina or McDonald's or something like that, where they are driving towards making a profit for their shareholders.
Yeah, and I think, you know, there's been talk about, well, the employees and, you know, this, that, and the other. I mean, you know, yeah, employees are one thing, but employees are basically there to serve members, and it's not that we're going to just dump the employees, but I think that if the employees are not committed to member service, then we have to basically reevaluate what's going on.
Yeah.
You know, I support headquarters staff. They work very, very hard. They work with very limited resources that are given to them, and they work with a board that doesn't seem to be, a lot of them don't seem to be concerned about the future of the ARL, so I don't fault them whatsoever. But at the same time, the board needs to understand that the first duty is to membership.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, yeah. Let's get back to this.
Now, we walk a fine line between these two needs, as that's our responsibility. My opponent doesn't understand that, and she wouldn't have, however, if she had the experience in ARRL
management.
And that's what I envision a code of conduct to be, and that is the direction that the board of directors has been taking and moving in. Now, it may take some time, but we will continue to work toward and ultimately achieve that goal. Now, I agree that members should always have the opportunity to express their views on any matter before the board in advance of board action. My opponent complains that she will consult the entire membership before she votes on anything.
That's called a straw man.
There are nearly 6,000 members in the Hudson Division, with each with differing opinions of what the league should be doing for them. Now, how are you going to do that?
It's easy. The internet.
That's not the type of governance that we abide by. We follow a representative form of governance, with a leader voted into office to best represent the needs of the whole. It's the same form of government that we have as a nation. Does your congressman or senator ever ask you how he or she should vote?
Yes, they do.
Yeah, they do, and they should.
That would be impossible. All right. So what this tells me is how naive my opponent is. It seems that she screams that she has no real-world experience or any idea of how the process works. The board always acts in what it collectively believes to be in the best interests of the ARRL, and that includes the membership and the entity. So balancing the needs of the members with the needs of the league is never easy, but that's the job of the director, and that's what I do each and every day, and I think I do a damn good job. I am concerned that my opponent and her friends are openly campaigning to sweep out the director.
All right, so let's stop there. That's for a quick one. You know, he's talking about political experience. I have actually worked with a number of political candidates, and in my previous job, I've worked with former politicians as political commentators. So I know what's going on with regard to that. But my former congressman used to send me surveys on a periodic basis and fill out and ask me about priorities. And the governor, I write him letters every so often. Like, I didn't like the gas tax. I wrote him about that. You know, I wrote him about, I even wrote him about amateur radio. And I wrote about a number of different things. So this thing about you can't serve with a membership, let stand by and let the board do its work as a crock. I think that it's definitely not, you know, he has no understanding of how a representative democracy works.
Yeah.
If you have a government that you elect, you can absolutely tell them what you think should be their priority. And if they don't do it, then you face them in an election, which was my main problem with his January board proposals, where he would have four new votes on the board that don't face re-election,
right,
that don't face the ability of being challenged. And then he will go on to talk about, do we want to sweep out the board? Well, you know, you go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, we do. Well, and this whole argument of, you know, people have to be there and had the experience to be there and they should be reelected. It's like, that's not how it works. You bring other people in when your constituents aren't happy with the job you're doing.
Right.
Then they get to vote you out. That's why we have the elections. Otherwise, we would just keep letting all the incumbents just stay there forever. And, you know, it's not the way it works.
Well, what is he saying now? Is he saying that he doesn't like competitive elections? Because
it just sounded like that, you know, that he's the right man for the job because he's got the experience and you don't have the experience because you haven't been there. Well, of course you haven't been there, but you want to be there. And hopefully the message that you're getting out is the message that, you know, the people that get to vote in the Hudson Division hear, and that's what they like.
And for the most part, it is. And I'll tell you something, though. A lot of people simply aren't aware, like I've told you before. But they're becoming aware. And the more they become aware is the more they're inclined to be, I wouldn't say angry, you know, to be engaged with this. And mm-hmm. they don't really like what's going on. And there's one club I went to that actually endorsed him. And this is another thing I want to touch on quickly. I don't ask clubs for endorsement because I think clubs should be neutral. But he goes and aggressively asks club for endorsements. And a number of clubs, by the way, would endorse me if I asked them to. And, you know, they've indicated as much. I've just not pursued it, but I've pursued individual endorsements. Anyway, so we just generally have to face this. You know, we just have to have the elections to deal with a new board every to re-elect a new board when we're not satisfied with the job that this one is doing.
Yeah, there's a comment in the Facebook room. Phil said, quoting, that she doesn't have the experience in the ARL management. He chuckles that that's part of the plus and why we need a paradigm shift, because you don't have that experience in the ARL management and in their ways.
Well, that's good.
Yep.
Right on.
Okay, let's keep going here.
I'm so angry that the overwhelming majority of the board had the temerity to censure the director for cause. Now, let's not forget that the board of directors is a deliberative body that has the right to police itself and to punish a member if necessary. Now, apparently, she feels that we don't have the right to punish a member of the DX and contest community. How many of you in here are DXers and contesters?
He is.
No, not field day. I'm talking about you live for every damn weekend.
So
they're not here. 24, 48, or 12 hours.
They're home contesting.
Yeah. Okay. She feels that the quote, like this is called icons of amateur radio, the quote, cream of the crop, contesters, DXers, the expeditioners, etc., the 10 percenters, as I call them,
MCOM leaders, too.
No better than the rest of the membership, and should be shown deference that 90% of the membership don't deserve.
Well, I never said that.
That's an elitist outlook. And it tells me that she really doesn't truly care about the vast majority of amateur radio. So tell me, does she really have your interests at heart? Is this the person you want representing you?
That was so weird, because he started with, and I take issue here, he started with the whole... people complained about the censure of N6AA.
Yeah.
And that they shouldn't be allowed to do it. And, you know, here's the thing. From where I sat, and the reason why I did a number of different episodes on it was not that we didn't think that they had the right to censure Dick Norton. It was that there was no conversation. There was nothing about why they did it. There was essentially a deep throat out there that complained about something that he didn't say at a meeting here at Visalia. And everything was attributed to him. And he wasn't even in the room when this happened. That a number of very well-respected DXers came back and said, that wasn't what Mr. Norton said. And mm-hmm. that they took him to task for that without any disclosure. Without any conversation, and that was what the issue was. It wasn't that they couldn't do it. It was the way they did it.
Yeah, well, the censure thing is that we don't know what the actual cause of the censure was. First of all, the official explanation has been that, well, he publicized and talked about the code of conduct, which to me is, if you're my director, I want to know what you can and can't tell me.
Yep, absolutely.
And, you know, he talks about the unified voice. Well, what happens when you propose something to the FCC and then a billion people don't like it and they comment on it and oppose you? Mm-hmm. You know, is that your unified voice? No. Excuse me. And the code of conduct was so bad that they had to end up rewriting it.
Yeah. They had to drop a lot of the stuff that we were all opposed to. We went through, Gary and I went through line by line on the show, highlighted line by line, and to get back to some of those things. There were some other accusations that Dick had verbally attacked some staff member at headquarters and caused someone to leave their job.
Mary
their
Hobart.
Position. Yeah. And, you know, I don't know, because it never was official, right? And I think if they had officially written down that on this date, this event occurred, maybe I would have sat back and said, wow, that's really terrible, and maybe something needs to happen. But just the way it got done was what rubbed me the wrong way.
Yeah, it's like, you know, and then the way it was done too is the president called a conference call and then, had people come in and vote on a censure.
Yeah.
So
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. All right, let's keep going here.
Yep, let's go.
My opponent prescribes to the My ARRL Voices platform, hell-bent on defeating and therefore sweeping out the five directors up for election this year. They plan on doing that again next year and the year after that until they have completely changed the face of the board.
We never said that.
This campaign by creating a voice and work atmosphere that caused the CEO of the ARRL to pack up and leave. That's a fact. It wasn't a fact. It's an fact. He just couldn't put up with it. He warned everybody and he warned everybody that if they didn't stop acting like a bunch of goddamn 8-year-olds, he would just pack up and leave. That's what he did.
Wow.
And I couldn't blame him. They've obtained the list of donors to the league. We went out and got the list of donors to the league. And then they contacted and directly encouraged those donors to withhold donations to the league. Does that benefit the league? You have to go out there and tell all your donors, hey, you know what? The league is screwed up.
Did that really happen?
Well, okay. So first of all, some of those donors were already angry at what was going on. And a lot of those donors are the 10% contesters and DXers that he likes to bash. Okay? And, you know, yes, there are people who withheld their donations because obviously if people are not acting in your interest, do you want to give them money?
I get that. And,
yeah.
But did anybody actually go out and solicit the donors to say, hold your funds back?
I don't know.
Yeah. That seems like a stretch to me.
Yeah, what I do know is that people in the MyURL voice group, like there was Scott Johns, W3TX, he said, well, I'm pulling my ads from QST because I don't like what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there were a number of letters that of people that wrote that got posted there saying that they were withdrawing. And you know, there were people that weren't, you know, I wouldn't say would be the leadership at the MyURL voice that said that they didn't think that it was worth continuing on a league. But it's different than going out actively soliciting supporters. And you know, kind of the way he made it sound like were the, you know, the large supporters, not just my $50, right? But the big supporters, that just seems wrong.
No, yeah, he might have extrapolated that from a Facebook post. Like I said, you know, Scott went on and said, well, you know, I'm pulling my ads. Who else is with me? And then nobody else really said anything.
Yeah,
and
that's really a stretch.
Yeah.
It's not like the league is going to go belly up. Like, how unhealthy is that? How just selfish that is that? They would prefer. Where was I? I get so goddamn worked up in this. They've obtained. All right.
It's a Mac.
They helped create a chaos in the ranks that now concerns the FCC. Oh, you're going to love this one. Causing us to lose face with the agency responsible for the oversight of amateur radio. How do we know that? Because hams who work at the FCC have told us that we are damaging ourselves with all this crap. Now, what is the benefit when the FCC, the agency that is responsible for amateur radio oversight, turns around and tells us, hey guys, you know what? Keep this up, you'll be 11 meters. What is that benefit? This is a critical time in the history of the league. We're quickly aging, and we've got to do something now to ensure the future of the ARRL. We need to approach the next generation of hams by finding common ground. I'm almost done, I promise. We need to learn how to communicate with each other to ensure the continued growth of both licensed hams and membership in the league. We must do this now because in another 10 or 15 years, many of us will no longer be around.
I agree with that part.
The legacy
just one thing.
We lead the future. Is that we did what was necessary today,
just a different approach
to bring the next generation of hams into the fold, to keep amateur radio alive as the vibrant service and hobby it is. Now, I know and understand the issues that are currently facing amateur radio. I have experienced having served in many capacities in the league. I have been and will continue to be your advocate in the division, in Newington, and in Washington. Do the right thing. Don't be swayed by political rhetoric. Listen to your heart and listen to your head. Keep the league strong now and into the future. And please, I ask, get your vote for me. That's
all right.
It.
Wow. Don't be swayed by the political rhetoric that I just laid on you for 15 minutes.
Hey.
Sorry.
I think he campaigned for me.
Well, yeah, I guess it depends on where you fall, but yeah, that kind of sounds like it there.
Wow. Yeah, and I think really, if anybody's engaging in rhetoric, ask people who've been to a club meeting where I talk about the future. I talk about vision. I talk about what I want the league to do. I talk about things like improving a website, improving, maybe getting an ARL app or something like that,
mm-hmm.
right? Or at least improving QST, because I have blind hams come up and tell me that they can't use it on a screen reader.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm like, for real? And I have another ham told me that, his VE credentials expired. He got no notification. I'm thinking to myself, how in 2018 that you did not get an email
right.
saying it's
free.
You know?
Email's free.
Yeah. Email's free. Yeah,
it's free.
It's low cost, I would say.
All right. Well, if it's already there, yeah. If they're already encumbered by having the email system, it's pretty free. I mean, yeah,
right.
It may take somebody to write that algorithm to check people's credentials to send off that automated email, but yeah, it's pretty free. So Ria, you're talking almost every night for the next month?
Yeah, iPhone on September is full of dots.
Good. Oh, that's good. I hope that you get out there. Can you record a session? Share it with me.
You know what? I will. I'll ask.
Can you?
What I have now, I have like a tripod.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll ask somebody to record me.
Even if you just put your iPhone on record and just do audio.
Yeah, I'm thinking about doing that. I definitely, because people have asked, and mm-hmm. That was the challenge. I mean, the challenge is I use my technology to present with. So
sure.
I have technology I'll use for that. I mean, I have a camcorder.
Yeah, camcorder. If you want to do video and send me video, camcorder, that'll totally do it.
Yeah.
Or even just an old phone that you don't use anymore, just put it on record and upload it and send it to me. I'd love to be able to share that with everybody, just to show the two different sides.
Yeah, no, absolutely, I'll do that. So I'm gonna be at this week. I'll be at a few meetings, and it gets intense for the next few weeks after that.
Okay.
I will be ping ponging between Northern New Jersey, Long Island, and Eastern New York, and it's going to be really intense, and I have strategy to deal with the travel. Frank has offered to have me come out to his place and crash, so I'm good. The retired director, Frank Fallon.
Mm-hmm.
So he's been a major help. I mean, Frank has just been, so good. And even though we have different approaches to governance, where I'll tend to be more in person and active. He's definitely been bringing on the support, and I've been actually bringing back a lot of disaffected people too, which is good.
Mm-hmm.
And, like I said, people are joining to support me, which should make my opponent very scared.
That says something. It really says something.
Yep.
Well, I want to keep talking to you, but not tonight.
Okay. Yeah, I think people probably will get a little bored now.
Yeah. So anyhow, I want to thank you so much for joining me for a second time. As we get closer to the election, my hope is to talk to some of the other candidates, of some of the other five. I'm really hoping to support change in my era because I am a member and I care. And then let's talk again. If you can capture me some content, I would love to post it up there. I am reaching out to all the candidates, even you know, you're the one you're running against, and offering them an opportunity to come out and talk to me. And we'll see where that all goes. And, cause you know, it's important. Everybody gets their word out. I have a bias obviously, but, but I also, you know, I want to give them the opportunity. I think we need change, and I want to thank you so much for taking your time out to join me and to support the league and hopefully, you know, support the league for the next couple of years and really run that change, drive that change.
Well, like I said, I'm not sure what the future holds in terms of tenure, but I don't want to stay there forever. What I want to do is lay a good foundation and a good framework so people can continue the work that I'm going to do, along with the rest of these hopeful new class of 2019, as we call it, right? So we're really going to push hard. I've been actually helping other candidates too. So, you know, yes, I am helping sweep out the board. But
you know, you're helping to drive change.
We're helping to drive change. Yes, and we're helping to make positive change, and I like to keep it positive.
Excellent, excellent. Okay, well, let me just roll through all this stuff I got to do. This was Ham Radio Now, episode number 403. Ria for Hudson Division. My guest today was Ria. N2RJ, and I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG. Thank you for watching. If you like what we're doing, please visit Ham Radio Now. Find Arvin, our chief financial officer, and click the pig. I need a little bit of funds to keep this going every month. There are 400 episodes in the can already, and part of me taking this over from Gary was to just to keep that great content there and alive and available for you. I get as many comments on the old stuff as I do from the new stuff. And I just want to keep it going. So you did this before. Do you remember the close?
Yeah, I do.
Excellent. Thank you all for joining us. This is David Goldenberg, W0DHG. Go ahead and give your name and call sign, and you do the beginning of the close, and I'll do the end.
Okay, this is Ria, N2RJ, over and?
Out.
All right.
I think the video thing even worked.
Oh, yay. It worked, yes.
All right, I will send you a link once I get it up. It's going to take a couple hours for it to all render here, but sure. But good luck, and we'll talk soon.
Yeah, thanks much for taking your time out your Labor Day weekend. I know it's going to be intense over the next few weeks. I'm going to definitely try.